Afternoon.
Hello.
I see a lot of faces from before and now, and converging. I'm having a Nabokov moment. You know, writing memoir is all about dealing with memory, and memory is a tricky thing. And I'm looking at you. You know, Ginny, and these guys, yeah. These are my boys I'm talking about. they came here with the guitar, and they just, we spent many an hour out there having great fun. Dr. Fine, very fine. And all of you, and there are people who are actually visiting for future potential mentee. You know, to talk about Nabokov, I'm getting really nervous because I really respect him so much. He's a tremendous. I mean, tremendous is not even a word. He's just the coolest dude. he by far, and I have. Read him, and I hate him, and I left him, and I go again and again. I go back to his writing. His writing has a power of his novels and his memoir has such a hypnotic power on me, a grip beyond I could sanely describe. This is guy Nabokov and guys like Jack London and James Michener, all those guys that truly feed me with all those nutritional necessities that urge me to continue to write. And you know that the reason why these guys were so good was because they love words. They really, really do, and especially this cool dude, you know, and very perverse guy, but and yet brilliant all at the same time. I just love how he could just he's a more of a philosopher than a writer. In one of the novels, he said that life is nothing but sorrow, and. History of the humanity is the history of pain. What? And sorrow, he said, in the end, is the only thing that we possess. Really? Not the real estate, not the Donald Trumps and all that stuff, you know. So it's stuff like that really hits you hard. And we only have an hour or so to discuss this. So I'm going to go, and our focus today is we're going to talk about memoir writing, but using this book particularly, Speak Memory, as a example, as a very, very fine example. I came to this memoir very, very late in my wanting to become a writer journey. If I had known this book and read this book first, I don't think I'll be able to write anything because it'll just stop you right there. Like, buddy, you ain't go anywhere from here. But the great thing about Nabokov is there are people who you read. There are two types of great masters. There's a type that whom you read, Saul Barrow, you know. You read him and you say, oh my God, I don't want to get up anymore. I can't write like him. But Nabokov is the guy who you read and you said, this guy is a maestro, and you want to get up and write. Saul Bellow stopped you right there. I mean, I read Saul Bellow's book and I said, this guy is too freaking brilliant. You know, I can't deal with him anymore. And there's no point in me writing at all because he's just so brilliant, extremely brilliant. But Nabokov, somehow, his brilliance inspires you so much that you wanted to write And you write a lot better, hell a lot better, because you are able to, he helps you to see a lot more clearer than other guys. So look for the authors who can inspire you to more. Jack London certainly does inspire me to write better, and but not William Styron, especially his Sophie's Choice, which is one of the masterpieces, one of the best, finest American novels. And in terms of a style, I just see these three guys as a huge stylist. There's Nabokov, there's London, and nobody talks about London anymore. There's only this Chinese guy who's talking about London. because I share something very similar with him. He is a guy who can work in the back of an Oakland hotel washing laundries for 18 hours. And then he left the job, and then he'd go on to write for 4 hours. That's sort of like me, you know. As a kid, I was a laborer on the farm, you know. So it resonates with me. He's a laborer. He's not a scholar, intellectual, but he just is all passion and from which beauty oozes out. And then there's a Styron. You have to read these guys to understand how these guys use words and how beautifully their sentence are parallels. If they can do with two, they will do with two, because two is always better than one. Speak memory is to me, I mean, there are a lot of Russian memoirs, and right after that, there are a lot of Chinese memoirs. But Speak Memory is one of the most exquisite literary memoirs of all time. And a lot of critics, you know, use this book to compare to when they review memoirs, and that's not very fair, because you are now, this is Michael Jordan, you know, and I'm like dribbling here in a elementary school basketball court. So a lot of very snobby critics will say, read Speak Memory, you know. But there's only one guy who can only write one book about that, and it's not fair to do that. But we can learn a lot from it. I think the most interesting thing you can learn is sometimes all my memoirs, two of them, and a lot of the memoirs that have been published nowadays is all a sort of a quest story. Straight, you know, somebody get taken down, and he or she stands up, overcoming all the obstacles to get to an end. That's a straightforward quest story. And that's like 99%, I would say. You know, somebody get divorced, and then eventually, you know, find a mate online, and then you have a fabulous life somewhere, eat, drink, and pray, you know. and man and woman, and you know, it's beautiful. But Nabokov doesn't write this way. And so I'm going to show you another way. If you don't have those gigantic, you know, heroic quest kind of story, don't worry, you still have stuff to write. And even if you have that quest story, right, you got taken down and now you have to stand up, eventually you succeeded and went all the way to the summit of your imagination, to the extremity of your desire, I could go on. But you can still feel the pockets of your memoir. I mean, these big plot things are just skeletal things. But how do you feel the other things? There's bones, there's muscles. How do you feel other parts to make this a whole human being, a whole book, richness? And it's all about richness. Everybody can, you can meet somebody in a bar and they can tell you many stories about survival. You know, I had this, I lost my job, and eventually, you know, I went to Florida and bought up all the, you know, real estates at the right time. And now I'm a zillionaire. and that sort of thing. But not all those stories will translate into a good book. And here, Nabokov in this book used very little. It seems like a lot, but it isn't. It's all broken pieces. There's no kind of a thematic linkage among to form a quest story. I don't think you can make a movie out of this book at all, because it's all observation on a very such a detailed observation of things. He actually used a method that is called symbolism. Symbolism is a symbolistic movement. Symbolist movement was something that was started in 1860s and 1880s in France. These guys are a bunch of poets. It's a sort of anti-movement against realism and naturalism. Realism, naturalism, to put it simply, is to depict the things as it is and to have it nothing. A cup is a cup, is a cup. It doesn't mean that, you know, anything else beyond this. But, and then came the symbolism people, and they begin to pay really attention to spirituality. And we talk about the word spirituality a lot, like spiritual and all that, but what does it mean? What does it mean anyway? But it literally speaking, it means the mental aspects of a thing or of an event vis-a-vis the material aspects of it. That's what it is. And in a day, everyday vernacular, when I say he's very spiritual or she is very spiritual person, I actually don't mean that so and so is very religious or so and so practices Zen and Tai Chi and eats just the organic, you know, roots and, you know, stuff that doesn't taste very good. I actually mean that person is supercharged with a acute awareness of his connection with all elements around him or her, and that person has a super acute sense of empathy. Whatever you feel, I feel for you. Bill Clinton, I feel your pain. Yeah. He's been spiritual when he does that. I feel your pain. So that to me is spirituality. And so this symbolism, simplest movement believe in spirituality, imagination, and dreams. So they get into the voodoo kind of area where literature use the realist will not go into, and the American practitioner of that would be Edgar Allan Poe. So he was, and definitely in music it's Debussy. You know, you listen to his music, it's all hugely imaginative, and he gives you the whole world in a few notes, and Wagner definitely. But and this stuff is perfect for Nabokov to use, because he doesn't have a really complete childhood. I mean, he came from a very wealthy family. I couldn't even figure out where they got the money to live like that. His governies in and out, there's a German governies, and there is a English governies, and French governies. And I think his grandfather was a minister of justice. And then his father was some sort of a parliament member, and then I could be wrong, But and his father was actually at one point was against the Tsar regime, and he was put in jail and all that. So he Nabokov's life was all, his family's life was all very closely involved in the whirlwind that was the Red October, 1912-1911 Russian Revolution. And that's where the his tragedy began. Hello. Chris Belding, everybody. Another guitar man, yeah. So, and then, so he also spent, from his writing, you sense he spent a lot of his childhood time outside the country. He went to France, he went to the beach, you know, southern France town, seaside village of cities, and also that sort of thing. So his childhood isn't in any way representative of a Russian childhood like Gorky's would be, in a very a very chaotic era of Russia. He represents only. That's why in a quote he said that my family, I think his loss of his childhood was even more traumatic because his family was the kind that was extinct. Never gonna be again. And so this method of metaphors and symbols and dreams and imagination and spirituality works really well for him. And there are two ways of, I mean, modern theories on our attitudes towards memory is twofold. One is one school of thought is Hegelian. We say that it's a voluntary active memory seeking. That's one school of thought. The memory is something that you can go and retrieve and actively put them into a narrative of meaning. Think hard, try to recall what happened, and then write it down. And another theory is Proustian. Proustian is a Proust, the French maestro who spent, I think, like 40 pages writing about getting up, getting out of bed, you know. So Proust, he believes in something else. He's a sort of pleasure associative kind of a method. His attitudes towards memory is passive. That memory that you leave yourself open in a form of a reverie, you just sort of out, you know, and memory will come rushing to you. And you let yourself embrace that. And Nabokov uses both. I discover that sometimes, so that is the active one, sometimes I discover that by means of intense concentration, reverie, the neutral smudge might be forced to come into beautiful focus so that the sudden view could be identified and anonymous servant named. So he uses both to combine to retrieve the memory to do that. And the thing about symbolism is it's basically
Through the method of metaphor, we endowse images and natural objects with meaning. And that is very different from allegory, which represents, say, oh, this book represents knowledge. That's allegory. But symbolism believes that you use images and objects to evoke a state of mind. That's all Nabokov is doing. And you see, you know, the unifying symbol is butterfly. And the guy is, you know, so into butterfly that it's sickening, you know. He keep talking about butterfly. But in that regard, he uses a butterfly. Butterfly is beautiful. To me, it represents beauty, it represents flight, but more importantly, you know, flight has all sorts of connotations, right? Escape and being fearful, all that, and all freedom, you know, whatever you can give the meaning to. And it's extremely beautiful, and a butterfly is one of the most magical creatures you could ever see. And he was so famous, he actually caught a field that was named after him. It's really crazy. And he was a butterfly kind of framer or cataloger at Harvard's at some point before he became famous or writing seriously. He was always writing seriously.
Before he had a real job teaching English, he was actually cataloging in a dusty corner of Harvard's Natural Museum. But he used a butterfly as a, and also, but more importantly, as the metamorphosis of butterflies is what exemplifies his life perfectly. And to a great extent, he equates what butterfly stands for with the creative process. Come from hugely ugly, you know, chrysalis, you know, and then the cocoon, you know, and then in due course, caterpillar becomes beautiful butterfly. From ugly duckling to princess. And that is our creative process as well. We work very hard, sweaty, you know, you don't want to see me writing because I'm all sweating and in California backyard, I have no shirt on because it's so hot. That creative process to me, it's always grungy and sweaty and oily and that sort of thing. And yet, in the end, when I see my words printed on a beautiful, you know, well typeset within a two beautiful hardcover, as I can't believe, you know, that sweaty stuff gets here, that people actually pay $25.99 to buy it. Just a sweaty man wearing shirtless. This idea of this movement fits him. I mean, this movement came to be, symbolism came to be before Nabokov was able to walk. I mean, he wasn't even born. So, it fits him really well for another purpose. That is, he's a real artist of words. And this thing believes in art for art's sake. That's where it came from. Which is trying to make this writing as exquisite as it can painfully be. I do not care whether you like it or not. I'm just going to make it real pretty. And pretty is good. And to me, it beautifies me when I write. I want to write beautifully. And we can write beautifully. I'm less of it. In my writing, I try to be, and my inclination is always try to write beautiful rather than write more realistically. That's just my choice. other faculty here would say, let's smack Da Cheng around. He's totally wrong. But that's just me. You know, I like prose style, and I love words, even though English is my second language, but I love this language. I love every syllable of it. I love the vastness of this language, because it has taken all its nutrients from all so many other languages. And it's open to be able to do though. In Chinese language, we wouldn't do that. We wouldn't include words like assassin and pizza, you know, and into our vocabulary, because it's not Chinese enough. But English language encompasses, embraces everything into its bosom, and therefore enriching it, language is its own language tremendously. So you could try this, you know, try to be exquisite as possible, and I totally, and after all, you know, rule number one of aesthetic is the word beauty. Aesthetic is the study of beauty. And art is about beauty. I was talking to my friend, a painter. He spent his time in a huge, you know, garage painting. Again, shirtless, with overall, and I said, what are you doing? You know, what are you doing? What is the process of painting? He said, it's pretty simple. I make a mess of it and make mess beautiful. And don't ask me what it means. I have no idea. It's for the critics from New York Times to tell me what it means. And I say, maybe you're right. So beauty, even in the, you know, those impressionist or modern art, it's, you have to create something that's palatable, that is edible to our eye. So people will buy like, it's beautiful, you know. I don't know what it means, but it, you know, cone stuff, you know, all those just square.
Yeah.
But if you study that square, that pink, the texture of it, I mean, every inch moves a little bit. And you begin to be fascinated by like, oh my goodness, I thought I could just, you know, throw a blot of paint onto it. But I can't, because it's very subtle. If you study cone stuff, it's, you know, that then soon this color begin to shift and you feel like you have some writing on some sort of a fireball, you know. It's amazing. It's amazing. And suddenly the distance between you and that painting disappears. You go inside it, or the painting goes to you. So be beautiful if you can. Be beautiful. And the poets in this class, you all write beautifully already. And but I would urge the prose writers, sell. In order to sell, what we can do is beauty. You know, I mean, if you've seen a recent movie, Danish Girl, oh my goodness, Tom Hopper or Hooper, what is his name, the director, starring Eddie Redmayne and Alicia Vikander, exquisite. He, in a present day movie making trend, I have to give a lot of credit for him, because every frame is a masterpiece painting. Every frame, it's just blow you away, beauty. And I did pay $13 to see it, and I'll probably see it again, because just you could sit there and soaked in a great beauty. Universe, physical universe. Symbolism believes that physical universe is just a language which few privileged can choose to decipher it. So all the objects that we see are merely your tools with which you can write your own book. You give meaning to them. And to write is to depict not the thing, but the effect it produces. And that's metaphor. That's Now, I want to show you a passage where this man can transform. In our memoir writing, our novel writing, whatever writing we do, we are creating a myth. When you write about your life, we're creating a myth. We make these little things huge. You know, just like Walt Whitman says that to a, I'm quoting clumsily possibly, but simply he says that to any real poet, there is no pettiness or triviality. Once he breathes into it, it dilates into grandeur. And then the things thought before as small become gigantic. So that's what you do. That's what we do, you know, breathing life into a petty little thing. And let's read a paragraph here. Do you all have some books? There is on page 73, very here to show that Nabokov said that he basically is so stuck with this notion of loss, so much so that loss became, he called, a robust reality that is more present than the present. So it is loss that he writes about. It's not the tangible objects or events he's describing. So everything is going to have this ephemeral kind of evanescent spirit to it. But on page 73, this quote says quite a bit about his attempt here. He said that my contempt for the immigrant who hates the rats because they stole his money and land is complete. Nostalgia I have been cherishing all these years is a hypertrophied sense of lost childhood, not sorrow for lost banknotes. And it's incredibly sad. And he is sad not for the things that you would think that is, but it isn't. He's so unnerved by, I feel that you could never make this man whole ever again. The loss becomes a robust reality. That's pretty sad. And that spiritual deprivation of his homeland almost become mythological. In this paragraph, page 36. For those who you have it. If I could read it to you, he make this into a myth. And we should try to do that. Let's listen to this. Sometimes, in our St. Petersburg house, from a secret compartment in a wall of her dressing room and my bathroom, my mother would produce a mass of jewelry for my bedtime amusement. I was very small then, And those flashing tiaras and chokers and rings seem to me hardly inferior in mystery and enchantment to the illumination in a city during imperial fetes. When in the padded stillness of a frosty night, giant monograms, crowns, and other armorial designs made of colored electric bulbs, sapphire, emerald, ruby, glowed with a kind of charmed constraint above the snow-lined cornices of house fronts along residential streets. Just the cornices of all those things. It's enchanting. There's sounds, sights, and all that in there. It's about nothing. The nothingness itself become hauntingly beautiful. And you almost feel that he has this eye of the sucking butterfly that he is, you know, dashing back and forth, capturing this moment and that moment, iridescent illuminations here and there. There's another episode, another one here on page 24. And I'm gonna read it, yeah. He said that the recollection of my crib with its lateral nets of fluffy cotton cords brings back too the pleasure of handling a certain beautiful, delightfully solid garnet dark crystal egg left over from some unremembered Easter. I used to chew a corner of the bed sheet until it was thoroughly soaked, and then wrap the egg in it tightly so as to admire and relick the warm, ruddy glitter of the snugly enveloped facets that came seeping through with miraculous completeness of glow and color. But that was not yet the closest I got to feeding upon beauty. What a pervert. Yeah, anyway. So he's already, you know, you see this little baby man, you know, doing the nasty things already. This is the eye of a butterfly. And butterflies is everywhere. He is the butterfly. So, and sometimes you sense that he's the butterfly waiting for metamorphosis. And in this page 173, I witness with pleasure the supreme achievement of memory, which is the masterly use it takes of innate harmonies when gathering to its fold the suspended and wandering tonalities of past. I like to imagine in consummation and resolution of those jangling chords, sometimes as enduring in retrospect as the long table that on summer birthdays and name days used to be laid for afternoon chocolate out of doors. I see the tablecloth and the faces of seated people sharing in the animation of light and shade beneath a moving and fabulous foliage. Through a tremulous prism, I distinguish the features of relatives and familiars, mute lips serenely moving in forgotten speech. I see the steam of the chocolate and the plays of blueberry tarts. In the places where my current tutor sits, there is a changeful image, a succession of fades ins and fades outs. The pulsation of my thought mingles with that of the leaf shadows and turns order into Max and Max into Lansky, these dogs' names, and Lansky into schoolmaster. And the whole array of trembling transformations is repeated. You know, it's metamorphosis. And it is, and then the next passage that is on page 226 is heartbreaking because he came to be at the time of tremendous chaos, and the war was going on, and he just discovered that he is a poet, and how sad. Because suddenly, this cocoon has to be punctured and spilled into this hostile world. The purity of a poet's heart getting tested and dirtied and tainted. And you sense that. This passage is on 226. My nerves were on edge because of the darkness of the earth, which I had not noticed muffling itself up, and the nakedness of the firmament, the disrobing of which I had not noticed either. Overhead, between the formless trees bordering my dissolving path, the night sky was pale with stars. In those years, the marvelous mass of constellations, nebulae, interstellar gaps, and all the rest of the awesome show provoked in me an indescribable sense of nausea, of utter panic, as if I were hanging from the earth upside down on the brink of infinite space, with terrestrial gravity still holding me by the heels, but about to release me any moment. He's unhinged, but he doesn't tell you the war is going on. He says the world is darkened and is muffling the nakedness, and he is hanging upside down. There's no incident where he could say, oh, I'm writing poetry, and boom, the bullets go through the window. There will be a realistic depiction of a tragic ruining of one's budding poetic inclination. But he didn't do that. He is the guy who can make nothing out of, making something out of nothing. And we should learn how to be able to do that. And you can. You have enough objects and stuff in your life to be able to make something out of nothing. And I think when you try that, magic could really happen. That's when you are really writing. When you are just writing the things that you know, that's the basis of everything. But the things you digest, that's even better. But the things you crystallized, that's gold. And this man can do that. And you read that, you say, oh shit, I can write this. You know, he's so good. But you can. And then he goes on to, anyway. So, all over this book, you could see he uses, the remaining years of his life, he just devoted to sort of to look for look for the golden nuggets of the broken memory. I mean, you see him digging on the beaches, chasing butterflies, and peeping through. The saddest thing is he always peeped through the window, train windows, and the glimpse, the birches, the fur that he seizes. And all this, if you go to 249 and 250, there's a very heartbreaking passage where he so beautifully used earthy symbol objects to represent the loss. I'm going to read it to you. To represent loss of Russia, basically. Very big. Tamara. The guy falls in love at age 9, you know. Tamara is his first love. Tamara is his second one, but there was a Colette, you know, the first one. So he's like a love boy through and through. And all this becomes the prototype for Lolita, actually, later on. You can see in his memoir. Lolita exists right here on these pages. He couldn't, again, he got stuck there because his loss was so profound that he couldn't uproot himself from that conundrum. So in this passage, he said, Tamara, comma, Russia, and the wild wood grading into old gardens, my northern birches and firs, the sight of my mother getting down on her hands and knees to kiss the earth every time we came back to the country from home, from town for the summer. These are things that fate one day bundled up pell-mell and tossed into the sea, completely severing me from my boyhood. It's heartbreaking. And then, but also he not just used that, all those images to represent and to evoke and all that, but he also tried to, the most fascinating thing in reading this book is how he built interrelationships among images and things, back and forth, space, time. He is at ease being the commander-in-chief of all the things within his orbit. And he can whip back and forth. For example, and in the page 81, I'm just read, I would often be read to in English by my mother. Before turning a page, she would place upon it her hand with its familiar pigeon blood ruby and diamond ring, within the limpid facets of which, had I been a better crystal gazer, I might have seen a room, people, lights, trees in the rain, a whole period of immigrant life for which that ring was to pay. So he's a little boy sleeping in bed, mother reading to him that memory, and then he saw his butterfly's eye, the ring, and then he thinks, whoop, Harry Potter, fly back to the present time. It's really sad to read that, like, oh my God. I mean, we would try to put it there, like, oh yeah, this is childhood, let's keep this memory beautiful. I did that in my memoirs. I wasn't skillful enough to do that. But he did that, and he's like stabbing into your heart with a dagger. Like, oh my God, how sad. We should do that. Learn to observe the things in your objects, in your life, and build a relationship among them. It's fascinating. That is the artifice of our act of writing memoir. If you don't have that powerful, you know, quest story, you know, you're gonna be the first astronaut of something, something. Then do that, because meaning of your life is everywhere. There's another passage at page 142 and 43. It's a travel case, and that's being handed down from to him. He said, "At a collapsible table, my mother and I played a card called Duraki.
It means idiots.
Idiot. Okay. There's a Russian expert right here. Although it was still broad daylight, our cards and a glass and on a different plane, the locks of a suitcase were reflected in the window. It was a long, very long game. On this gray winter morning, in a looking glass of my bright hotel room, I see shining the very same locks of that now 70-year-old valise. A highish, heavyish necessaire de voyage of pigskin, necessity of travel, I guess, with HN elaborately interwoven in a thick silver under a similar coronet, which had been bought in 1897 for my mother's wedding trip to Florence. In 1917, it transported from St. Petersburg to the Crimea, and then to London, a handful of jewels. Around 1930, it lost to a pawnbroker its expensive receptacles of crystal and silver, leaving empty the cunningly contrived leathern holders on the inside of the lid. But that loss has been amply recouped during the 30 years. It then traveled with me from Prague to Paris, from Saint-Nazaire to New York, and then through the mirrors of more than 200 motel rooms and rented houses in 46 states. The fact that of our Russian heritage, the hardiest survivor proved to be a traveling bag is both logical and emblematic." Really sad. You think a very, very simple object. Now, I relate to it because the life of exile and loss of that kind of family. It sounds like my father's lighter, you know. And he also can transform a very simple image into a supernatural, almost supernatural proportion. For example, in this, the guy is writing about toilet, okay? Page 84 and 85. The toilets were separate from the bathrooms, and the oldest among them was a rather sumptuous but gloomy affair with some fine panel work and a tasseled rope of red velvet, which when pulled produced a beautifully modulated, discreetly muffled gurgle and gulp. Just a toilet, come on, you know. From that corner of the house, one could see Hesperus and hear the nightingales. And it was there that later I used to compose my youthful verse dedicated to unembraced beauties, morosely survey in a dimly illuminated mirror the immediate erection of a strange castle in an unknown Spain. I know what you're thinking when you see the word erection, yeah. It's not Barkov, anything can happen, yeah. So, but magical, enchanted, supernatural. Can we do that? We can. Must we do that? We must. To make your memoir, your fiction writing richer. This is what it's meant by literary, you know. When we say, oh, he's more literary, that's what it is. You are making beauty out of your beauty making and bringing meaning out of it. You could, to a child's eye, anything can be majestic. And we bought a lot of expensive toys for our son, but his favorite childhood toy was turning over a tin can and beat the hell out of it. That's his everything. Well, I mean, I can go on forever, but the most important thing is, but I just want to close by this one little passage that I think nails it all on page 251. He said that a sense of leaving Russia was totally eclipsed by the agonizing thought that rats or not, no rats, letters from the Tamara would be still coming miraculously and needlessly to southern Crimea and would search there for a fugitive addressee and weakly flap about like bewildered butterflies set loose in an alien zone at wrong altitude among unfamiliar flora. Mwah! Isn't that just delicious? Now it comes the whole circle, butterfly again. It's always butterfly. He is the butterfly, let loose in a forever, butterfly forever, until he came to America. And later on he became successful writing Lolita, and then he returns to Europe. That's where he passed away. So, I think we can do that. I just really appreciate the opportunity to share this and read this book and many books. But learn to, I'm learning every day, you know. It's in Chinese, there's a chu xi, there's a rub, and then there's a subtlety, minuteness. And we should learn to be able to do both. And life is pregnant with meaning. And you have to be the person, to be the mother, giving birth to it all. And I'll shut up now.